we move to our last presentation of the day, and that is from Alison Russell and Pauline Cockrell, and they're talking on motoring memories. And if I turn up the page, I can tell you that Alison is a director of the History Festival and community programs at the History Trust, and Pauline is a community history officer also within the History Trust of South Australia. Thank you.
All right. I don't think I've been in this lecture theatre in about 30 years, and the last time I was in here was for the most horrendous honours Common Course exam, so I'm certainly feeling warm to be here now. Look, I should begin by saying that this paper is not really so much part of the history stream as museum studies and museology. But I hope that what Pauline and I have to share will be of some interest. And if not, please feel free to speak because we're getting very close to dinner, conference dinner time. So I'm going to present first. And just give a little bit of background, Pauline is going to see us home. So Pauline and I have a plan for world domination. We kind of sleep a cell at the moment, but be warned that at any time we might set our plan in motion to make the world a better place, one museum interaction at a time. Starting perhaps with large working objects like motor vehicles, because they are perfect for our purposes of changing the world. Today we want to share something of our blueprint and see if we can create some converts amongst you. Pauline and I met when we first started working together at the History Trust in 2010, and we discovered very quickly then that we had a common belief in bringing together wellness, health, ageing and museums. We've both travelled overseas to explore these connections and concepts more closely. And today, Pauline's going to share one of the projects that we did a few years back after I've given you a very brief background on some of the research in this area. So I should point out that we're not alone in this quest. There have actually been very many manuals published on the subject about how we might go about it, and that they're not all on the dark web. This is something that's happening in the light. Indeed, there's now significant and growing literature into the area of memory and museums, and we'd like to share something of our own experience researching this. The leader in this field is a woman called Professor Helen Chatterjee from the University College of London, who some years ago conducted a three-year study which proved what many of us working in museums know anecdotally, and that's that interaction with museum objects is actually good for you. So the History Trust has collaborated with University College in London on a similar study here in partnership with Flinders Medical Centre, where we took a box of museum objects directly to patients' bedsides. They were allowed to handle them and shared their thoughts and memories with a facilitator. The object box used included some objects from the National Motor Museum, the South Australian Maritime Museum, the Migration Museum, and the South Australian Museum. You can see in this photo that Dave is holding a hood ornament in his hand, and that this particular box also contains an SX6 badge from, I think, the 1930s. These are objects from the Motor Museum's handling collection. These objects sparked all kinds of conversations and recollections. Choosing the objects that we could use in a hospital setting was a little bit tricky. They need to be wiped clean in a hospital environment. Obviously, infection control is important. And they need to be not too heavy to handle by somebody who might be frail and lying in a bed. They had to be small objects. They had to be things with hard, polished surfaces. But those two that I've described have really done the trick as conversation starters, sparking all kinds of memories. We conducted pre- and post-visit evaluations based on the University College London research framework, and it confirmed that the interactions had a positive response on patient well-being. Now that might seem to be a no-brainer, that someone coming to your bedside to talk to you when you're in hospital for a lengthy period of time makes you feel better. And that's true, it is a no-brainer. But they also tested conversations with an ordinary, a person coming to the bedside, but no objects, no museum objects to handle. And they also tested the objects without the facilitator there. And in all cases, there was actually an improvement in patient well-being, but the objects and conversations combination proved to be the winner. Since that first study, Helen and her team in the UK have looked specifically at the benefits of touch and other multisensory experiences to people living with memory loss. As we age, we know that our sight can fail and hearing as well, but touch apparently less so, and smell as well. In the UK, there's been a huge growth in the interactions between museum sector and ageing. There are organisations such as the Age Exchange in London, which is a cross between a community centre and a museum, and programmes such as the Museum of Liverpool's House of Memories, which brings aged care workers into the museum setting for training in dementia care and runs a really wide variety of programs for those living with dementia. And they have online and on-site programs. Most recently, Helen's team is engaged in some research around museums on prescription. The idea that participating in museum programs can actually have direct health benefits. And so there are doctors who get out their prescription pad and will write a prescription for a patient to attend museum programs. So Pauline and I have spoken about these ideas before, and we've sometimes been met with some degree of bafflement. This is museums we're talking about. They're full of curators, not social workers. So is this really to be doing these kinds of projects? So let's have a look at the definition of a museum. And this is the International Council of Museums' official definition of a museum. And I think it would be fair to say that generally museums focus on these, the acquisition, conservation, research, communication, and of exhibitions. And that's our core business, our bread and butter. But what if we looked at these bits? In the service of society and its development, and for enjoyment. I think that opens up a whole different way of exploring museums. So I'm now going to hand over to Pauline, who's going to share something of a project that we did a few years back.
Okay, thank you, Alison. Can you hear me? Okay. So I'm going to outline a project that we worked on together called Motoring Memories. That aimed to put some of the theories that Alison has just discussed into practice. Now, this was a joint project between the National Motor Museum, the Morris Register of South Australia, and Resthaven Aged Care Facility in Northern, which is in the eastern suburbs of Adelaide. So how did this come about? Well, to start the wheels turning, sorry about that, was that in 2010, the Morris 8, or as it is known in Australia, the Morris 840, was celebrating its 75th birthday. And the Morris Register of South Australia, formerly known as the Morris 840 Club, wanted to recognise this occasion in some way. They'd been doing some visits to the local Resthaven homes with their cars, and they'd come up with a plan to develop this, and perhaps to capture some oral histories, both of their members and Resthaven residents, with the aim of perhaps creating a publication. So they'd been thinking about this, and they came to us, Alison and myself, who at that time were juggling hats between being both curators at the National Motor Museum and also involved with the community programs arm of the History Trust. And they came to us to request help in developing their idea. So after some discussion, we discovered that it so happened that Resthaven was also celebrating its 75th birthday, as it was established in also 1935 as Resthaven, the Methodist home for old folk. And this was a really happy synergy to have both the Morris 8 and Resthaven both celebrating their 75th birthday. And we thought we could combine the celebration, and we worked on a programme together that would have beneficial outcomes to all. Now, let's just stop a moment to consider the Morris 840. I'll just look back at some of its history. It replaced the Morris Minor, and it was first launched at the Motor Show at Olympia in London in October 1934. And its claim to fame was that it was a relatively cheap but reliable little car, which in Britain at that time just cost £118, with £2 10 shillings extra for bumpers and trafficators. It was immediately popular, and this is the most important part, and one of the most important things, was it put Morris back on their feet after the Depression, so regaining its position as Britain's largest motor manufacturer. And for the Australian market, this 8-horsepower vehicle was known as the 840. And it was introduced in Australia in early 1935 and was sold in various forms until 1948. There was a Series 1 and 2 with two body options, an open tourer, two-seater and four-seater, or a saloon, two-door or four-door. And then there was the later E-series, which I think you can see up there on the right-hand side, which is easily distinguishable by its waterfall-style dummy grille radiator, and I think it looks rather like the Noddy car myself, as well as a van version of the E, which became the Z-series, and a special utility version for the Australian market. However, for this project, the most important thing, as far as as this project is concerned, was not the car's technical specs, but its ability to evoke fond memories. The Morris 8 was a universally popular car. It was often people's first car, both in the 1930s and still reliable in the 1950s as a second-hand car. In fact, you mention it, and people say, oh, I had one of those, or my dad had one of those, or that was our first family car. Because we believe that the thing about cars is, and I'm sorry to say this to an audience such as yourself, it's not just about blokes, and it's not just about what's under the bonnet. Cars evoke fond memories and many personal milestones. Now, the theories Alison described previously have led to many museums creating themed memory boxes using historic items in their collection to aid in reminiscence therapy and general well-being amongst the elderly or those with dementia. But we, in fact, can see cars as huge memory boxes in themselves. They can take you back to your childhood. You might remember what your car, your dad first drove, or where your best seat was in the back of the car, or where your family dog sat. You might think of travel sickness, picnics, family holidays, the driving, learning to drive. All your senses can react to them. The smells, like leather, petrol, oil, or even vomit. The touch, the feel of the leather, the sun in your face, or perhaps you might remember your first naughty in the back of the car. Then, of course, there's getting married, the wedding car, your honeymoon motoring adventure, and then later bringing baby back home from the hospital, buying your first family car, and then it all starts again. Picnics, family holidays, the caravan. And then there's all the paraphernalia, or should I say petronalia, that goes with driving, such as tools and oil cans, as well as other motoring items, such as maps, gloves, picnic baskets, travel rugs, etc. So, with this in mind, we developed the following project. The main event was for the Morris men, I'm sorry we called them, to take some of the residents out for a spin in their cars on a pre-arranged day at the rest haven home. And I'll talk about this later, because that was really the highlight. But in preparation for this, we delivered professional oral history training, organising some workshops with a small team of volunteers from the Morris Register at their club rooms with a staff member, as you see here, Catherine, who was then working at the Migration Museum, and also an expert on professional oral history training. We showed them how to use a high-quality digital recorder, gave them tips for interviewing, as well as the protocol for copyright, etc. And we arranged for the recordings to be burnt onto discs by the State Library. We did some practice runs with their members, as well as some serious interviews, including this member on the right-hand side at the top, who worked at Motors Limited, Flinders Street, Adelaide's oldest motor firm, registered on the 9th of May 1911. There was also the intention that they would do some follow-up oral histories of some of the residents regarding their motoring memories, with conversations that they would have had during their spin around the home as being a warm-up session. And also, at the same time, for preparation for their day out, Jill, the lifestyle coordinator at Bresthaven, did some motoring memory sessions with her residents to ascertain who might be good for interviews. And she used photos, images such as these from catalogues and car manuals and websites to start discussions. And she got these from either the Motor Museum or from websites, or things that she found herself. And as well as the day out, there was also, for the 75th birthday of Bresthaven, they had a special open day. And one of the Morris Register brought his Morris 8 to the open day. And we also, at the Motor Museum, prepared a small display in the Bresthaven foyer with some motoring memories inspired objects, which you can see here. This was left at the home after the open day for a period of time to encourage conversation between not only residents, but also staff and visitors. And you can see here a toolbox and picnic basket from the 1950s. The picnic basket was led by a family friend of Alison's, and the toolbox came from the museum, which was used during the 1950s on a 1949 film mix. The driver drove from Adelaide to Perth 16 times to visit his brother. And this caused a lot of conversation between residents and visitors. It was very successful. And so I'm jumping forward as well from the spin. After the day out, we singled out three people from the home to interview, returning a week later to interview them at the home, using the equipment and skills learned at the workshops. And here you can see Joan, who's telling her motoring memories to the Morris Register men, who are now using their well-honed skills in oral history. And her memories are now stored at the State Library. Jumping to the outcomes, and I'm going to talk about the actual day out that we had right at the end as a sort of finale, but the outcomes were various of this project. It was certainly an example of successful community engagement and was a win-win situation on a number of counts. For the museum, there was the opportunity to collect general motoring stories, even donations of items and photographs, such as we actually got some offer of photographs on the we displayed some things at Bresthaven. And all this was helpful for research and potential content for future displays, web content, and it was also a possible source for new volunteers and visitors to the museum. And for the Morris Register, there was the opportunity to learn new skills and enhance well-being of their members. And for Bresthaven, there was the opportunity for therapeutic reminiscence work for residents to enhance their well-being. And this was probably the most significant part of the project for us, and what this paper is all about. And so I'd like to end with outlining some of the highs of the day when we actually took some of the residents out in the cars. So here we see, there were actually five cars on the day at the home. There were four Morris 840s. There were three Series 1s, one Series E, and a Rogue MG Magnet Saloon, but that's not in the picture. Fantastic about the day to start with. It was just a beautiful, beautiful sunny day in a week that had been very rainy and dull. It was like a day like today. So the cars arrived in the car park, and everyone had who wanted to spin could go around the block with the drivers, not on their own, obviously. We covered things like health and safety and all those sort of things. And so everyone had a chance to go. This is actually the padre, had the chance to go as well. They just went round the block, came back in the car park. And you could either have a spin, but you could also just chat in the car park and look around the car, or you could do both. And then afterwards there was a morning tea in the day lounge, and we showed more photos and images relating to the motoring on the big screen there. That's just a quick view, so what was the outcome? And there was immediate response for the day, was we could see that lots of people ventured out into the car park as soon as the cars arrived. It was like nothing was happening. When the cars arrived, suddenly there was just loads of people in the car park wanting to see the cars, chatting, not only the residents but also the staff. And what was lovely was that lots of people came who ventured out from their rooms who didn't normally come out. And there was just lots of smiles everywhere. Everyone was just obviously having a great time. But then there was also the heartwarming anecdotal stories after the event that we heard from the staff much later on. and I just want to share a few of them because they really are just lovely. There was apparently a gentleman who has, he was very, very depressed, as often is the case in you know, when you at the end of your life in a residential home. He was very lonely. He just didn't talk to many people. He just stayed in his room all day. People were very worried about him. He was almost at the point of giving up. And he actually came out on that day and was just having, and actually talking to people, which he hadn't done for a long time. So that's just really, really lovely to hear. There was a gentleman here who's actually in that car there. He had, he's actually had a walker, couldn't walk very well, but he really wanted to get in that car, and he did. And he wanted, he grabbed my arm and said, please take a photo of me so I can give it to my family, because they won't believe me that I went out in the car today. And there was another lovely story about, there was a lady there, it was actually the anniversary of her husband dying, which normally was a very, very sad day for her, but she told us that that day was just really special for her. It was just a lovely day, much better than it had ever been, and it was a time she could remember her husband in a lovely way. And there was also a resident there who had severe dementia, and we saw her on the day. She was having a lovely time. She went for a ride. She was obviously interacting with people, chatting, talking, obviously enjoying the moment. And when we asked her about it the following week, she had no memory of it whatsoever. She couldn't remember, but she said, they told me I had a lovely time. So there you go. So there were also fantastic outcomes for those who assisted on the day. The Morris men, as we called them, had a ball showing off their cars. They were grinning ear to ear as well. And the staff who knew the residents well also found the day very uplifting to see some of the residents change so dramatically before their eyes. And for us, well, we're still talking about it 7 years later, and we've worked on several memory box projects since then, and this is still one of our major highlights and successes. So, in summary, cars can be used in museums on so many levels. You can talk about talk, that's T-O-R-Q-U-E, or you can also just talk, and it just might make you feel better. So we hope this short presentation has demonstrated that.
Thanks very much. What an inspiring experience. Yeah. Questions?
It's not a question, it's more of an observation. For me, I believe, apart from people's houses, homes, I think a vehicle is one of the only pieces of personal property where people can immerse themselves. And what I mean by that is not only the sense of feeling, smell, touch, hear, etc., but it's also a womb-like structure which elicits primeval responses and evokes pre-birth comfort and serenity and a mother's like movement. That's it.
Yeah.
I don't know how other people feel about that.
For me, it's my own personal space.
It's my own personal space. So it sort of says, you know, I don't want to drive in any old car. I want the car that says something about me. Yeah, it is like a home, and yeah. Do you think?
I have never thought of that metaphor, but it's actually a really nice one, and one that I think takes motoring out of what is that conceptual male domain and into a really nice female one. So thank you for sharing it.
I'd really like to support that when. I think back to when our family got our first Holden 48, 205. It was such a dramatic moment in our family's life. And I agree with Stan, it's much more important than the houses we ever lived in. It's what it represented, that we could suddenly afford something nice to drive in, a car with wind-up windows, not a horrible old thing with a canvas hood, and I reckon God forbid, but if I get dementia, I'll be talking about that.
And cars can take you places, a house can't.
Yeah, I think as well, for most people, when they get their first car or they get their driver's license, it's that moment of freedom and that moment of transition from childhood to adulthood as well. I think cars are so important, so much part of who we are, and our motoring memories. I think that's something that I always found working at the National Motor Museum. Yes, we had more male visitors than female visitors, but I always believed that more than any other museum I'd ever conceptualised, everybody has an association with motoring, and those memories are so important.
Other comments?
Just a little question, and it's a personal thing for me in terms of research. You were saying those oral histories, some of them are available from my perspective. That one that you had of the chap that worked at Motors Limited, is that available for research?
I'd have to check it out. I can't remember. I assume that it was done.
Because I would be particularly interested in hearing that one.
I can check it out for you.
Yeah, I also agree with the wheel-like thing. My brother told me that once, but then I figured the car sort of wraps itself around you.
Mm.
Yeah, that security, so... Yeah.
Hopefully it never squeezes you out.
Abort, abort.
From here?
Ladies, I think what you're doing and what you're... is just fantastic. From a Victorian perspective, we're in the unfortunate position where we have no state-level museum, as far as motoring is concerned, but we do have a very active movement. Unfortunately, I see it a lot through my role and what I do for the RACV, attending a lot of events, a lot of club talks, where they get some of the members who've been members for 50 and in some cases 60 years, they'll sit them down and have a conversation in front of the clubs, and the one thing they don't do is record. They just report it in half-page article in the next edition of the journal, but unless somebody has actually pressed record on their smartphone, that's the sole repository of that information. But on the other hand, so many of the clubs do this, they actually go down to the regional or the local old folks home, for a choice of a better word, and do this once a year. It's just a shame that we don't have, at this stage anyway, and I must admit you've certainly piqued my curiosity here, of actually combining the two. And just an observation is that one of the tasks that I do for the RACV is fit a vehicle in the front of the building. And more often than not, it's the E.H. Holden or the Model T Ford that attracts the attention rather than the multi-million dollar vehicle. And the conversations that you actually have with the people walking past, and I recall one, and I've got to admit that this is a little self-serving, in that the lady was with her daughter, and the daughter was talking to me across the barrier rope after I'd installed a Model T Ford, and the conversation turned around, and the older woman, who was well and truly into her 80s, mentioned the fact that she was from my local area, she lived on her own on the farm, and she had an old car in the shed, which is now in my shed. And it's a 1925 Beam 14 that had been in her garage for 20 years. She'd just forgotten about it, but this piqued her curiosity. She spoke to the family, they coughed up, and I coughed up, and sure enough, there is an ulterior motive, but these things have a habit of working. Yes, there are the stories that go with it as well. So, well done, thank you.
I was going to say, in Victoria and Geelong, at the National War Museum, they're very much key towards working with dementia. They have dementia room, so maybe, I don't know whether cars, you could work them together with them.
Daryl, have you written the stories down yet?
Yeah.
Maybe record them on his iPhone.
We probably have time for one more question or comment, if there is.
Yeah,
speaking about a birth you mentioned earlier, right now at the Jam Factory, down the road on North Terrace, there is a display by local artist Margaret Dodd.
It's actually Ace Open.
Yes, that's it. You know about it?
Yes, I haven't seen it yet. But
right. A woman, somebody making love to an FJ, a woman marrying a man FJ and having birth to an FJ, holding.
That doesn't sound fun.
Very nice. Very nice.
I mean, I can't, my point
goes,
yeah.
It's a move. It's
really
okay.
Okay, thank you very much. Very much indeed. Very interesting. Thank you. That brings us to the end of our formal paper sessions. So we have time now to move out and regroup at 6:30 for 7 at the Sporting Car Club of Adelaide for the conference dinner. And for those coming to that dinner, we have Philip Guilfoyle talking about his 3D printed mould project, Keeping Australia's Automotive Heritage on the Road. So the Sporting Car Club is at 51 King William Road in Unley, and we can finish up now and regroup there, and there'll be an opportunity for you to have another set of conversations with colleagues there. So thank you very much for today, and we'll see you at the Sporting Car Club later this evening.